Hi everyone. So today we'll continue with mathematical functions, characters and strings, and we'll also basically get into loops. Before we start, I just wanted to tell everyone that I posted the first homework and it has 5 problems and you basically have to submit it on Blackboard. And I usually and try never to modify an assignment after it's posted. So there were 2 questions that were asked on Piazza. First of all, about packages. So for this assignment, you don't need to do anything about packages. If you use the package, we will basically remove it ourselves. So it's up to you if you want to remove it yourself or you leave it to us to remove. The second is the output is supposed to be printed exactly as it's required. So the question that was asked was about question number 5, if the output should actually also contain the stuff within parentheses, basically how the number before it was computed. And the answer to that is yes. Basically what is required, you're gonna output exactly that output, basically. When you will output here the amount, you will also put space and then within parentheses how that amount was computed. And you eliminate the ones that are zero, for instance. So for instance, this does not have miles after 100 miles. So that will be eliminated. It will only appear when you have at least 100 miles and then extra, like 160 miles. This is the only things that basically you follow the instructions to the letter. Now, there are no instructions about packages here, so you can assume that you can use a package or not. I already, in the second assignment that I'm planning to post this weekend, will be a week late. Go ahead.
Dollars back, okay.
Okay, that's fine. Please mute yourself if you that's awesome. Okay good so let's continue with mathematical functions, and we talked up to random. So we basically talked about maximum, absolute value, we talked about ceiling, floor and round. We stopped at math.random. So math.random returns a random value. It's a pseudo random value because basically you don't have a random generator in the computer. It's a deterministic machine, but basically it takes any kind of signal that it sees on the network interface and applies a hash function on it. So basically it gives you a value that is pseudo random. It's hard to predict, not impossible, but hard to predict what you get as the value. So random gives you a value between basically 0 included and 1. And you can basically get from that random value any other value. You can multiply it with 10 and that will give you a value between 0 and 10. You can cast it to an integer and then it gives you integers between 0 and 9, not 10, because since math.random will never be 1, these values will always be less than 10, 9.999. And when you truncate it to the integer part, you basically get at most 9. Therefore, if you want to generate a number in a different interval, like for instance, from 1 to 10, you would add 1 to the value that you would get in that interval. In general, if you want a value between A and A plus B, excluding A plus B, then you can basically add A to math.random multiplied with B. Now, one thing that random numbers are used for is to generate random letters. So for instance, if you want to generate a letter between lowercase a to lowercase z, what you can do is the following. First of all, what we said here is you want to generate a random number between a and a plus b, not including a plus b. We have a similar case here. You want to generate a random character code from A to Z. First of all, what you can do is to find what's the distance between Z and A. So that gives you the number of letters in the alphabet. You add one to it, because basically this will not reach Z. Math.random is between 0 and 1, not including 1. Then you multiply math.random with that distance that includes all the number, all the characters in the alphabet A to Z, lowercase, and you add A to it. Now, since A is already an integer, you don't need to do this cast. Since Z is an integer, you don't need to do this cast or this cast. So the expression simplifies to lowercase a plus math.random multiplied with the difference between the characters Z and A plus 1. And then you cast this to a character because math.random is a double. So if you wanted to use it as a character, you have to cast it to character type. So this is basically an easy way for you to generate random characters. And you can replace, for instance, lowercase a and lowercase z with uppercase a to z or 0 to 9. It will generate a random character digit from 0 to 9. Now, you can remember the codes for characters. Like for instance, 0 corresponds to 48, then 9 corresponds to 57, 10 characters afterwards. A corresponds to 65, low uppercase A and lowercase A to 97. But in fact, you never need these codes because every single comparison that you would want to make, you can make it directly with characters. So if you want to check if a letter is in uppercase that the user entered as a character in the input stream, you can just compare if that character is greater than or equal with uppercase A and less than equal with uppercase Z. Similarly for lowercase or for digits. Okay. So let me actually show you this code. So let's actually start a scanner. Let's read one character. And there is no function in Java to read a single character. So one thing that we can do is to use the input scanner to read an entire line and then get the last character of that line. So input dot next line character at index 0. So what that basically, it changed while I was typing it. What this basically does, it reads the entire line. This disregards what the rest of the line did. And then it basically kept only the first character. The character at index 0 is the first character of the string. Okay. So now we can actually see how this works. So it's waiting for us to enter a character. Let's lowercase a is a lowercase letter. Uppercase a, s is an uppercase letter. And if you want, like for instance, a digit, it's a numeric character. And for things that are not any one of those, like for instance, let's say that we have dash, it basically ignores it because none of these if statements actually did anything. Okay. Now, one thing that I can do here is to put this whole thing within a while statement. So I can actually try multiple at one time. So now I can enter one character at a time. So A is a lowercase, uppercase A is uppercase, 1 is numeric, dash is nothing because basically none of these if statements worked and so on. So now this can actually be written in a different way. And that way is with the class character. So the class character is a class that already exists in Java lang, which is the same package that actually is imported by default in your user space. and you can basically use classes from that package without having to import them, like the math class. Somebody was asking that in the chat a couple of minutes ago. So isDigit basically will take the character as a parameter, and it succeeds with true if it's a digit, or it returns false if it's not a digit. So basically in our example, in this example at the end, instead of checking that the character is greater than or equal with 0 and less than or equal with 9, I can just write the character is a digit, ch. So it does exactly the same thing as before. Instead of checking the range, it actually checks if it's a digit. So the same thing for the other functions. So isLetter will check if it's a letter. isLetter or digit checks, returns true if it's a letter or digit. isLowercase returns true if it's a lowercase character. isUppercase if it's an uppercase character. And then there are two functions to transform a lowercase character or an uppercase character into a lowercase or into uppercase. So these other two can be written as character is lowercase, and the one above can be written as character is uppercase. Now, there was a function here, isLetter or digit. isLetter or digit is actually the disjunction of the four, the three cases that we had before. So really is the same with checking that it's in uppercase, if it's in lowercase, or if it's a digit. So this is the case that it is an alphanumeric, no matter if it's lowercase or uppercase. So now we can basically run this, and you see one is alphanumeric, A is alphanumeric, uppercase A is alphanumeric, and equal sign is neither. It's not an alphanumeric character, it's not. Okay. So really this is how we combine multiple of these conditions with a disjunction. Okay. Any questions? So let's see the chat. It's part of Java, is actually in Java lang. So it's actually imported by default.
Can you go back to the code real quick?
Yes.
Professor, quick question.
Yeah.
Do you prefer us to use like the dot is uppercase and dot is lowercase rather than like doing like the long version
of the code? Either. It doesn't matter.
Okay.
Because in effect is exactly, it has the same effect. So I personally like to write it explicitly myself, because this way I know exactly what it does instead of relying on Java to do it for me. But it's really up to you, because actually I was checking lowercase above and uppercase below. But it's really up to you which one you want to use, because they are both equally good.
Got it, thanks.
Welcome. Okay. And the last one is basically checking for digits. So I can change this to 9 and this to.
What does the factor at 0 stand for?
What stand for?
Character at 0. After next line dot character.
Ah, character at 0, this one. Very good question. We'll discuss about it in a couple of minutes, which is right now. The string type. So one character represents just one character. When you've read car, ch is equal with lowercase a, within single quotes is one character. To represent any number of characters, any sequence of characters, including 0 characters to welcome to Java, you need to use another type in Java called a string. So a string is basically a longer, it's a reference type that stores a longer string. It can store from empty string to any string, welcome to Java, as long as you put it within double quotes. String is again one of the predefined classes in Java. It's in the same package, java.lang. Now, first thing to notice about string is that it's not a primitive type. That means that the variable is not actually the string. It's a reference to the string, is an address of the string. So this is something that I mentioned earlier in the last class. Let me actually again draw it because it's easier to see what I mean. Primitive types, when you define something like integer I is equal with zero, I is actually an alias for a location in memory that contains the number zero. Okay, so it's exactly like this, that I is a location which if you assign something to it or you read it, it's exactly in that location. There are only 8 primitive types, 4 integer types, 2 real types, Boolean and character. Now, every other type in Java is called a reference type. And what basically happens is that the variable itself is not the string, like hi in this case, but it is actually a reference, an address in memory to the actual string. So we'll basically have a string object that contains that actual value. So here is string, and in this case is hi. Okay. And why is this important? It's important because when we actually compare two strings, for instance, we will compare with a method instead of comparing it with double equal. So for instance, if we have a different variable here, let's say integer j is equal with zero, in a condition I can actually write is I equal with j. And basically what happens, it looks at the location that contains I and the location that contains j, and they are both zero. So they will say, yes, yes, this is true. They are both equal because this location is equal with this location, everything is good. For strings, it's a little bit different. So for strings, let's say that we define another string, string S2. And this contains a new string that contains the string hi, exactly the same string as before. In memory, this will look like this. S2 is a location, and that location is a reference to an object of the type string that contains hi. Basically exactly what we had before, but in a different place. So something like this, okay? Now, if you are doing a comparison with equal, so if you're asking is S equal with S2, Java will tell you false, which is totally correct because it compares whatever is in S, which is this address to some object, with whatever is in S2, which is a different address. So this is, let's say, 5 address in memory, and this is 10 address in memory. And of course, those two are different. So it's totally correct that S is different than S2. They are not equal. So for strings, we are using a different way to actually compare the content of the string. And the different way is the equals method. So we take one of the strings and we invoke the equals method with the second string as a parameter. So basically what happens now, we are asking, is actually the string high, the string S reference to high, is it equal with the same content with the string that is referenced by S2. So now it will tell us true, because this is actually the way to compare actual strings in Java or any other reference type because you are not relying on the double equal only works for primitive types. You are relying on the method that is defined for that string class to compare the two strings. Okay. Okay, so there is a question in the chat. Let me try to read it. Is this why there was no next string? There is next double, next int, but for reading with a scanner, there is no next string. Maybe I would assume that actually the reason why is that there are primitive types that you can read, and anything else that you can read is only strings. So it's kind of like writing a compact method to read strings. So I don't think that is that's the reason. You would have to use next or next line. Next is up to the first white space, next line up to the end of the line. Okay. So I don't think that's the reason. I think the reason for that compact API is just that it's shorter. No other reason. Okay. But now we can get to the methods. So the first method is the one that your colleague was asking about, character at. So first of all, each character in the string is stored at an index. The indices start with 0 for the first character, and then they increment with 1 for every other character. So in this sentence, the character at index 0 is A, the character at index 1 is space, the character at index 2 is S, and so on, up to the character at index 10 is T. So this sentence variable has 11 characters in length, and the indices range from 0 to 10. For instance, if I want the character at index 6, the character at index 6 is E. So this print statement will print the character at 6 is E, because that's the character at index 6. Sentence to uppercase returns all of the a statement in uppercase letters. There are methods, there are a lot of methods in string. There are about 100, but we will actually see a subset of them, around 20 or 30. The next method is called substring. It also uses indices. It returns a new string that is a substring from position 0 up to position 7, not including the character at index 7. So in our case would be a state, because basically it's the substring from 0 to 7, not including 7. 7, the upper range is never included. Another way to invoke the same method, substring, is only to pass in the beginning position. So for instance, sentence.substring from 14 will return the string from position 14 up to the end of the string. It happens that in this case, 14 is out of the string. It's basically not an index in the string. So this will actually return the empty string. There is nothing after position 14. That position doesn't even exist. So there are one thing that to know about strings is that strings are immutable. Basically, there are no methods to change a string. Strings, once they are created, they cannot be reassigned a different value. Any new assignment is basically a new string that is now stored in the old, referred by the old variable. So consider this example. We have a string, word is equal with Steven. That's the name of my nephew. And basically, it has indices from 0 to 5. And to word is assigned word.substring from 0 to 5. Meaning that I extract out of Steven, Steve. That is a new string that is created. And now that variable is now overridden with a new address of the new string. So it's not that the old word became Steve, but it is that the old word is now a reference to the new string that contains Steve. Okay. So let me actually show you as a picture what this does. So let's go back to Paint, delete everything. And we have this code. OK. So first of all, we define a variable word that is Steven. And then we have this assignment that to the word, we assign the word at position from 0 to 5. Okay. So what happens is the following. So first of all, the word is created, and this is a reference to an object that contains a string, which is Steven. So this is a string that contains Steven. Now, word.substring from 0 to 5, 0 is S, 5 is N, will create a new object. And this new object contains only Steve. String, and that's Steve. That's what basically this statement does. This statement basically creates that new object in memory. The moment that we assign the result of that statement to word is basically that we are rewriting, we are eliminating this old link by assigning to this link, to that location, to in word, the address of Steve. Okay. So basically, this old word Steven is not accessible anymore. It will be garbage collected by Java. Java will remove Steven from memory. Word is referring is a new address that is now referring to this new object that is Steve. So strings cannot be actually modified. They can be just redirected. The variables of the type string can have a new address now. And this is a new address of a different word in memory that contains Steve. Okay. Any questions?
So now, where is the location stored?
Okay, that's a good question. So the answer is actually a little bit complicated, okay? But I will explain to you. So the first word, the original Steven, this object, is in the global segment. So the reason for that is that this appears as a constant in the program. So Steven,
static data, right?
It's a static data. In Java, this is called an interned string because it's basically a constant that Steven is found in the program and the compiler will take it and it will create the object in the static data. Now, the second word, this Steve, because it's created at runtime by running the substring on that variable word, this will be created in the heap, or what is called the dynamic memory, because it's created at runtime and is going to be created per need basis. And per need basis in the sense that this is executed, so we need to create a new string at runtime. Okay. So strings that are found at compile time as constants in the program are basically collected, and only one instance of every one of these strings is actually available in memory. As opposed to strings that are created at runtime or with a new operator, in which case they are all created in the dynamic memory at runtime. You basically create an object, you allocate the space for it, and you put it in memory. So actually this is important for the next thing that I want to tell you. So we talked about the difference in equality. So let me actually tell you a little bit more about that. So first of all, there are two strings. Let's say S1, and this is Steven. And string S2, and this is also Steven. No, because this is an internal string, it's created at compile time, only one object will be created. So we will have in the global segment of memory a single object of the type string that contains Steven. Okay. And both of these variables basically have the address of that object. So this is pointing to this object. And also this is pointing to the same object. Okay. And why is this important? Because now you can actually compare them with equal. And this is true. It's the same. You will get exactly the same if you compare them with dot equals. This is also true. And the reason for that is that dot equals basically compares, is the content the same? Yes. Double equal, are these two variables, this one and this one, the same reference? Yes, they are, because they are basically the same address of the same object in memory. So they can be compared with equal and they can be compared with dot equals. But this is only because these are internal strings. These are constants that are found in the program and the compiler creates one single object, a unique object for every single constant in the program.
They're stored in global, right?
And they are stored in the global static segment. Yeah. So this is stored in global or what is called static segment of memory. Okay. Now, there is a different possibility, and that is when we have two strings, kind of like before, but a little bit different. String S1 is equal with a new string that contains the string Steven. And the string S2 that is another new string created at runtime that contains the word Steven. So now the first one is a reference to some object that contains a string that is Steven. And the second one is also a new string that contains Steven. So the two variables actually contain the addresses of those two each. So this contains the address of this Steven, and this contains the address of this Steven. Okay. But now if you want to compare them with double equal, obviously they are different because the address here is different than the address here. This is an address here, and this is an address here, 5 or 6, and they are false. However, the equal sign still works because what equals does, it compares the actual content of the two objects. So it goes to S1 and says, is this content equal with the content below? And it says, yes, Steven is equal with Steven. These two objects are going to be stored in the heap because they are basically created with a new operator at runtime. So it's not this constant, the constant that is actually Steven, that after which this string is created, is in the global segment of memory, in the static segment. But these are new strings. So they are going to be in the heap, both of them. So one thing that you can actually see is the fact that dot equals always works fine. So for strings, it doesn't matter if they are interned or not, you're gonna use dot equals in order to compare them. One of the dot equals methods, there is dot equals ignore case, which basically ignores the case of the two. There is also a method that compares the characters, and one by one from the beginning. And then it basically tells you if there is a difference in character, I'm going to give you the distance between those two characters. That's the method compare to. So another method is s1.compare to s2. And in this case, it will return zero because basically the two are the same. But if they would be basically two different strings, then it compares the first characters, then the second characters, up to the ones that are different, and then it returns the difference in the Unicode between the two. So basically it returns a positive value if the first one was greater than the second one, or negative if the first one was less than the second one. I can show you a couple of examples, in fact. Let me delete this and show you a few of the compares too. So let's say that we compare AA compare to AB. So this will actually return minus one because basically what happens, the first letter is the same. The second letter A is less than B exactly by one because basically it's the Unicode of A minus the Unicode of B is minus one. And if you have the opposite case, if you compare is B compared to, let's say AA, it's one because basically it just starts from the first character. Is B greater than A? Yes. And by how much? By one in Unicode. Okay. So the length doesn't matter. Basically, what matters is the fact that basically we can find a character either that is bigger than the other one. And starting from the beginning, it tries to find the first such character and take the difference between the two characters. Okay. Good. Now, concatenation of strings. So basically, there is a method called concat. So I can basically show it to you. B dot concat with A. It basically returns a new string that is the concatenation of B and A. But because it's very common that you do concatenations, the plus symbol was actually overloaded with concatenation if one of the operands is a string. So plus between B and A is still the same, is BA. Okay. So that's exactly what plus is used for. When you use it between numbers, it does addition, but when you use it within strings, or a string and a number, or a string and the character, it does concatenation. So it's welcome plus two plus Java. It basically concatenates all of them into welcome to Java. Chapter plus the number two, it concatenates chapter with the number two after this number was transformed into a string. In Python, for instance, you have to explicitly transform it. That's because it's a strongly typed language. In Java, it's a weakly typed language, weakly in the sense that it accepts this kind of cases where you have a string and a number or a string and a character. And it still works perfectly, basically does concatenation in this case. So there are a lot of useful string functions. Character at returns a character at a given position, starting with index zero. Equals checks if two strings are equal. Equals ignore case, checks if the two strings are equal, ignoring the case of letters. So uppercase letters are equal with lowercase letters in the equals. Compare to is a function that returns an integer. Zero if the two strings are equal. A positive value if the first string is bigger than the second string, a negative value if the second string is bigger than the first string, and I told you how. Starts with checks if a string is a prefix of another string, ends with if it's a suffix. Index of checks if a character is in a string and returns the first position of that character in the string. Now, index of has... it works for characters or for substrings. And it also has another argument called from, which basically you specify from what, from where you are looking forward for those characters. Last index of is the last index of a character in a string or of a substring in a string. Replace will replace every occurrence of a substring with a different string, or similarly for characters. Substring extracts a substring from a given index to another index, or from a given index to the end of the string as a new string. To lowercase and to uppercase, basically return the string with all letters in uppercase or lowercase. Trim removes white spaces at the beginning, at the end of the string. So basically it trims the string to only the letters in the string. So eliminates the beginning and ending spaces. We start with equals. So equals between a string and another string returns true if the two strings have the same letters, have the same content and sequence. False otherwise. Now there are also special characters in strings. So backward slash n is new line. It's like a slash that like a person leaning backwards. Backward slash t is stands for tab. Backward slash double quotes is the quotation mark inside the string, because if you wouldn't escape it, then it will be interpreted as the end of the beginning double quotes, basically the end of the string. But basically this allows you to put within a string double quotes. Similarly for new line, so basically n is interpreted here as a new line character. So I will use it later. If you want to print, for instance, a table, you can use it to print the new lines at the end of each row.
Professor, quick question.
Go ahead.
Sorry. For the string functions you were talking about earlier, is it the same syntax like through which like we use each of them? Is it like dot char at?
Yes. So for instance, dot character at zero, dot length, message dot length, message dot character at 14, and so on. So here we have an example. Message is welcome to Java, and I want the character at index zero, message dot character at zero. I want the length of the string, the number of characters in the string. It's 15. The last character has the length minus one index, because we started with zero for the index of the first character. So basically message dot character at index 14 is A, the last A in Java, in welcome to Java. And similarly, if you want to read the string from the console, like your colleague said in the chat a couple of minutes ago, you would basically read it with two methods. One is next line, which reads the entire line, no matter what, if you have spaces or any other type of characters in the line. Next reads up to the white space. So basically, I can show you one thing. So let's say that I want to read two strings, okay? So string S1 is input.next, and another string S2 is input.next. So now let's put a breakpoint in that line and run it with the debugger. So now basically I'm at this line. So I execute it and now it's waiting for an input. So here we say blah, blah. So what happened is that it read in S1 blah up to the first white space. The rest of the input is still in the pipeline. So when I read S2, it reads whatever is in the pipeline. So that's why I personally never like to use next. If I can, I would use next line, because it reads the entire thing. So if the user of my system has some garbage after, like, I basically read the first word, it will be deleted. So if I do s1.nextLine and next line, it will read actually two lines with whatever input is there. So actually, let's run it. I wanted to run it with the debugger so you can actually see what's happening. So here I have blah, blah, and that will be read in the variable S1, the entire thing. Now, if I want to read another string in S2, fla, fla, it will be read in the next string in S2. So next line is a little bit better in the sense that you read everything line by line. You don't leave anything in the pipeline. So here in this example, I basically read three words separated by spaces. This will leave in the pipeline and read each one of them. Now, if you want to read a single character from the console, you basically read an entire line and then read the take the character at index zero. This is the only way to do it in Java. You can't listen on the command prompt to read a single character. There is no matter in scanner to do so. Don't compare strings with double equal. Always do it with equals. As I told you before, if you compare these two strings with double equal, it will say that they are equal. If you do it with a new string, it will say that they are not equal because basically double equal compares their addresses. If you do it with dot equals, it says true because they are the same string internally. One thing to be careful about is that for internal strings, they are the same address. So double equal will work, but so does dot equals. So dot equals is always going to work. So it's always better to be used. There are other methods to compare strings. Equals ignore case, which returns true if the string is equal with other string, even if it's case insensitive. Compare to, which returns zero if the two strings are equal, a positive value or a negative value, indicating that the first string is greater than the second string for positive or negative, that is less than the second string. Similar to the equals method, there is an compare to ignore case, which is kind of the same with doing lowercase, two lowercase for every one of the words and then comparing them with compare to. Starts with, checks if a prefix is the prefix of a string, and ends with if it's a suffix of the string. Obtaining substrings, there are two methods. Substring where you give a single parameter, meaning that I want the entire substring from that index to the end of the string. For instance, message.substring at 11 will return Java because basically starts from position 11 up to the end of the string. Substring from a begin index to an end index basically extracts that substring from the begin index up to the end index, not including the character in the end index. So for instance, if I want welcome to up to this space, I would do message.substring from 0 to 11. So it's up to this character, but not including the J. Okay. That's the substring method. Index of. So index of has different forms. The first form takes a character and returns the index of that, the first occurrence of that character in the string, okay? Or minus if it's not in the string. So let me show you an example. So I define a string as one. Let's say that is bananas, okay? And let's print the first occurrence of A, system.outprintln S1 dot index of A. Okay. So it will be one. Basically, it's the first index of A, which is one. If I want, I can get the last index of A. So last index of A. So that will be five, which is the index of the last A in the string. Another way to run index of is give me the first index of A starting from some position. So let's say starting at position three. So now it basically at position three, there is an A. So basically from that position, the first index of. Similarly, you can basically get the last index of starting from a position. If you don't have the character in the string, let's say x, give me the index of x in the string, it will be minus one, a negative index telling you that is not in the string. There is no x in bananas. Okay. So those are the methods. Index of a character, index of a character from a given string, index of a substring, index of a substring in, from a given string, last index of a character, last index from a given index of a character from a given from index, last index of a string and from a given index. So this doesn't work only on characters. It's not necessary to just put A, but you can actually do also substrings. Is there an NAS in bananas? And it will basically give me the index of NAS. So starting at position 4, there is NAS in bananas. Okay. So this basically gives me the index of a substring. It does, it works on strings or on characters. So here is an example of using basically all of these methods, substring, index of, and so on. So let's just say that we are reading names, first name, last name, as a single string from the input, and we want to tokenize it. We want to extract the first name and the last name. And they put, the user puts Kim Jones. So the first thing that I would do, I would find the index of space. So K is the index of space in the string S, which was read, the variable that holds this string from the input. First name is the substring between position 0 to K. So if the index of space is 3, the substring between 0 and 3, not including 3, is Kim. So basically, first name will be Kim. And last name will be starting from position K plus 1. So from position 4 up to the end of the string is Jones. So that basically extracts the last name. So this is a simple example of how to use index of and substring to do a simple tokenization. Tokenization is to extract each individual word. In this case, it's just from a name that has first name and last name separated by spaces. There are also methods for converting between strings and numbers. So if you have a string that represents an integer, like 15 in this int string, or a string that represents a double, like 56.77653 in double string, you can use two static methods, integer.parseInt of the int string, and you can assign that to an int variable, or double.parseDouble of the double string, which you can assign to a double value variable. If you want to convert the other way around from an int number to a string or vice versa to from a double to a string, the easiest way is to concatenate it with empty string, because that basically will transform it into a string for you. You don't need to actually use a method. You just do a concatenation and weakly typing will give you a string of that number or of that double. Now, when you print out things, like for instance, let's say that we want to print the result of division 1 with 0, or with 3. You get 0 followed by 3 in a period. So a lot of digits after the decimal point. So let's say that I don't want to get that entire string. So let me show you the example first. So what is 1 divided by 3 in real? 1.0 divided by 3 gives you 0.33333 in a period. Let's say that I don't want this entire number. I only want the last, the two digits after the decimal point. This is maybe a monetary value that we had to split some price, like $1 in three parts. And we only want to find out that we each have to give 33 cents and one of us puts the extra cent. We use the method printf, print formatted. So it contains the format and then the items that will be for will be printed. The format is a string that is like a pattern. It consists of substrings and format specifiers. Each format specifier starts with the percent sign and then how specifies how the item should be displayed. So there are multiple format specifiers. %B for Booleans, %C for characters, %D for decimal integers, and so on. %F for floating point numbers. In addition to the format specifier, you can also specify the number of digits that you want to print after the decimal point. So in this example, it basically .2F. It tells us that I want two digits after the decimal point. I can also specify on how many characters I want to print this number. So let's say that I have 1 divided by 0, and I want two digits after the decimal point out of that number. Oops. Ah, I didn't specify that this is a float. Sorry for that. So now you can basically see what happened. What did I do? I basically used the format specifier that said I want two digits after the decimal point for this float point number. Moreover, I can actually tell it also on how many characters I want this printed, on 10 characters, okay? So now if I print it, it actually prints it on 10 characters aligned to the right-hand side. So this is very useful when you basically want, let's say, to print a table. So basically you have multiple numbers that you divide by 3, okay? And you want to print them one under another, even if they have more digits to the right-hand side. Let's use a new line character in front of each one of them. And now run it. And it will look like a table. So basically, it's 0.33, 4.0, 4.33, and so on. And they are all right aligned. Even if they have more characters, like 150, let's say, for the last one, it will be 50.00. So it always maintains two digits after the decimal point, no matter what. And it's basically aligning them to the right-hand side. So they are all printed on 10 characters with two digits after the decimal point as a float number. This is the print formatted. If you want to print multiple values, so let's say that I want also to print another float number. So /space, and also, why not the same? I have to add an item to each one of these statements. So now I have, let's say I want 1, it's easy, 2, 4, and 5, because these are not in reals. Let's actually change them to decimals. D. They are not floating point numbers. They are basically integers. So I basically now also printed this on 10 characters. And again, it doesn't matter if some of them may have more than 10 character, then 1 character, it will be basically all of them will be on 10 characters aligned to the right hand side. Okay. Any questions? Nothing in the chat.
Professor?
Yeah.
The second column, the list of the numbers, where does 1, 2, 32, all those come from?
So he basically the number of formats that you have has to correspond to the number of items that you are passing after the format. So basically, maybe it's easier to see in the example that I have in the lecture notes. So I have an integer and an amount, and I'm printing the count is that integer percent D, and the amount is percent 2F, and then you have the count and the amount. So for each format specifier, it's basically corresponds an item. So this is what is called a method with variable number of parameters, because basically the number of parameters is the number of format specifiers that you have in the format string. So if you have two format specifiers, you must have two items following the arguments of printf. If you have one, you have only one. So in my case, what I basically did, I added one argument extra to each one of these printf statements, and I added that basically this. Oh, if your question is what is this 10, is basically I'm specifying that I want that number to be printed on 10 characters. So this is a constant. You are the one that puts it into whatever size you want.
Understood. Thank you.
Welcome. Okay. Now, one more thing that I want to tell you about functions is that there are also binary operations in Java. So because we write programs and the programs internally work in binary, you can also do conjunction between binary numbers, disjunction, shift left and shift right of these bits. And here are a bunch of examples. For instance, you have two numbers, number one and number two. Number one is 12, number two is 25. And we do the disjunction between number one and number two. So basically, number one, 12 is 8 plus 4, so it's 1100. 25 is 16 plus 8 plus 1. Yes, so basically it's 11001. And you are doing binary operation between them. So let me actually show this to you. So for 12, we have 1100. And we are doing conjunction with actually disjunction in this example, disjunction with 11001. And the result of this is 1 or 0 is 1, 1 or 1 is 1, 1 or 0 is 1, 0, 1. So this is 16 plus 8. Plus 4 plus 1, which is basically the integer number 29. So the result that will be printed here as the binary bit operation between 12 and 25 is 29. So let's actually try it. So if this is run, the output of this program is basically 29, exactly what I said that it is. Okay. That's how binary operations work. And there are also exclusive OR, which basically does exclusive OR between the corresponding binary bits, binary digits. The complement or the negation of a number flips every digit. So 110 becomes 001. You can shift left the bits. So for instance, instead of doing multiplication with 4, you can shift left a binary number with two positions and fill it with zeros. That's equivalent with multiplying with basically 4. If you shift only one digit and put 0 instead of it, it's like multiplying with 2. The number of shifts that you are doing is basically multiplication with 2 to the power of that number of shifts. Now, integers are also negative numbers. One second, please. So integers are also negative, and the first bit of every number, of every integer, is basically the sign bit. So there are actually two ways to do shifting. One is shifting with 0 with sign extension, meaning that the sign remains the same. And when you shift, you basically get a number with the same sign. The second one is called shift with 0 extension, meaning that you actually shift also the bit. The problem with that is that a negative number can become a positive number because you are shifting also the bit, the sign bit. So that's basically it. Now, one thing in Java is that when you assign a number to a byte, it's to any integer number, it's expected to be in decimal, but you can actually enter also binary. 0B followed by the bits is the binary version of that number. Similarly, if you want to enter a bigger number or a long, for longs, you put L at the end, and that's basically knows that is a long number. Okay. If you want, since Java 7, it's very hard to see how many bits you have there. Since Java 7, you can actually use underlines in within your binary number. Those will be ignored by the compiler, but what basically happens, you can actually see what how many digits. You can group 4 at a time or 8 at a time from the right-hand side. So now you can actually count the number of blocks. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 blocks of 4 bits, which is actually 4 bytes. So that's an integer. A long is much longer. You can also enter octal. So if you put a 0 in front of your numbers, it will immediately know that this is in octal. So let me actually give you an example. If you put 010, this will be the octal number 8 in a decimal. And 0, let's say 0 star F is the hexadecimal for the decimal number 15. So this is a way to enter numbers that are in different bases. Good. Okay. So now, any questions about all of these mathematical functions?
Quick question about the sign.